start talking. Okay, so it is Friday, drama-free Friday again. Hello, everybody. Come on in. Grab something to drink, and you might need a snack today because this is going to be some serious fun we got going on in here today. Hey, Marion. Hi, Nancy. Hello, Petka. Yeah, you'll notice I have a strange man in the studio today. I'll tell you all about him here in a second. Hi, Allie. So, can you guys hear me okay? Hi, Dawn. Hi, Annette. And Ian.
Hello.
They've already figured you out. They saw it in the chat, in the list. Hi, Michelle. Hello, Linda McAllister. Hi, Lisa. So, does it sound good for you guys? Yes? Okay. Because we did some messing around with the sound, testing the sound last week. With after the show, so I wanted to make sure we got it set back up. Thanks, Dawn. Okay, alrighty. So, how's everybody doing today? I hope you're doing well, having a good week. Just chatting with everybody for a minute so we can see. This is where we see the number of people, you know, as they're coming in and so forth. Ian got a crash course in how the show works. Hello, Ina. See, this is the one that I always want to write her name.
Oh, okay. Yeah. This one letters flipped around. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah, pen and ink. Exactly, Linda. Exactly. Animal Lecter. Paloma. Hey, Paloma. Of course I'm not sick of you, Nancy, for goodness sakes. Never. Hi, Nina. So I see some new names popping in the chat today, so that's welcome. I'm glad you're here. And so we're going to go ahead and get started because we got lots of things you guys are going to enjoy seeing. Lots and lots. Hi, Kathy. Hello, Pavla. Hey, Steven. Steven's going to be here for a while. Okay, Steven's in Canada. Pavla's in the Czech Republic, so we have people coming in from around the world.
All over the place.
Yeah. Hey, Margaret. We are going to answer all those questions. I promise, Margaret. We're going to answer those questions.
So, ink is the answer to that question.
Ink is the answer. Ink is the answer.
Ink and watercolor.
Ink and watercolor. Cool.
So, without a doubt.
Okay, so, yeah, it's Drama Free Friday. This week around the world was a little bit crazy, as we all know. So, our thoughts and prayers go out to the people in England this week. Tough stuff going on over there. So, just wanted to make mention of that. So I'm not a complete idiot when it comes to knowing what's going on in the world. I just choose to ignore it most of the time because the show is called Drama Free Friday for a reason. But anyway, that doesn't mean that I am not sensitive to what's going on. So the sponsors are safely locked behind door number one back there. I'm sure you'll hear them because they hear a strange voice out here in the studio. They want to come see. Muppet has already investigated and so far has given her seal of approval that all is right in the studio today. So anyway, I'm really glad you guys are here. And this is a real special treat for me to have a guest in the studio. Normally, I'm doing a remote hookup with someone. And so to have Ian Cody, who is my guest, in the studio with me is a real treat. Now, I have to tell you that the way I met Ian is kind of funny. Most of you know, or many of you know, that every afternoon my husband and I go and get coffee or tea someplace. And we've done that for 25 or 30 years. And it is our way of decompressing from the day. It gets me out of the studio, gets me away from work. And when he is working, it gives him a chance to come and we just kind of download the day and, you know, kind of decompress from everything. That way we don't bring it home with us. Well, we kind of periodically switch up the place we're going. And currently we've been going to Barnes & Noble bookstore. And Ian is one of the baristas back in the cafe. So I don't know exactly how we got started talking about the fact that he was interested in art. And I think I just picked up on something that somebody said one day. And I'm like, you do art? So it all kind of went from there. So we've had a lot of fun talking about art. And he's shown me a lot of his artwork, which I'm going to show you before I get started talking to him. I'm going to show you some of his art to to tease you a little bit, and then you're going to get to see the real thing. Go get a coffee, Linda. Hi, Kia. Let's see, who else is here? Ellen from Denmark. Hello. Let's see. Hi, Dorothy. Dorothy's in the UK. Good to see you, Dorothy. Hi, Jane. Yeah, Jane's in the UK, too. Miko. Oh, my goodness, Miko. For show. I have not seen you in forever. I'm so glad you're here. Hi, Carol. Ellen. Lorraine. So welcome, everybody. It's great to have you all here. So, okay, what I want to do, first of all, is I want to show you, give you a sneak peek into some of Cody's, Ian, listen to me, into some of Ian Cody's artwork. So this is Ian's link on, or his social media, get the mouse out of the picture there. This is his Instagram account. Yes, I'll get it in a minute. So for the moment, you guys, I can't see the chat. I'm just going to give you a sneak peek here at some of Ian's work. So take a look at these. Now, you're going to get to see some of the real deals here in a second, but this is ballpoint pen, right, Ian?
Correct.
Okay, so listen, folks, if you guys think that you have to go out and spend $1 million on fancy art supplies, it's not true. It is not true. See that pen right there? See the pen? That's what he drew that with. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's look at another one. So here's another. Now, where do you get the color that you have in there? Where is that coming from?
That's actually highlighter. I was at my girlfriend's. Yeah, I was at my girlfriend's work
that's
when
great.
I did this one. And I had my pen and I wanted some color, so I took some of her highlighters.
Highlighter and ballpoint pen.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, I'm gonna show you a couple more, and then we're gonna see the real deal. But this is on Instagram. You'll find his Instagram link down in the description box below the video window. You'll also see, if you want to follow him on Instagram, there is his name right there, the Ian Cody Club. Yeah, is this also ballpoint?
Yep. Yeah, it's just a black ballpoint pen.
And let's look at one more. I love the conglomeration of things that you,
yeah.
The amalgamation, I guess, is a better word.
It's a lot of different symbols thrown in one, so.
That's great.
Trying to find a concept, sometimes I throw a whole bunch together to say something.
Okay, so you guys better not, I don't ever want to hear it again that you can't do art because you couldn't afford to buy the stuff, right? Mm-mm. Yeah, don't even go there. Don't even go there. Okay. So beautiful. These are some of the comments. Let's see. Nancy says you look nervous, but they won't bite.
I don't know what to do with myself.
That's all right. It's all right. You'll know in a second. We'll get you busy drawing. People are loving it. Love the houses.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. And if it's blurry, there's lots of technology going on. So if it's blurry, you'll get to see the real thing here in a second. Okay. So before I start asking you a bunch of questions and picking your brain, I want you to hold up some of the big pieces there.
Sure.
And let's just show some of the big pieces first of all. So you show them in any order you want to show them. And
we're going to
show them in here.
For sure.
So
I'd say this is probably the latest one.
Why don't you just hold it up and show it here.
This is the latest one, like larger piece that I did.
Come in a little closer. Here we go. This is one of the pieces you just did.
Yeah, it started out as just a little pencil doodle. It turned into something. The other one turned into something completely different. But it's just more of a take on, say, virtual reality media, and that we're kind of living in some controlled world or whatever. People are detached, was the idea from the natural world.
So what we've got going on here is computer monitors.
Yeah, TVs, computer monitors.
Up in here.
And this one's not quite done yet. I wanted to, like on the other ones, just splash some color onto the television sets. So this one's still a work in progress. But I was at a certain point that I thought I could still show it.
What is, what's your paper that you're working on?
This is watercolor paper.
Watercolor.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So it's not like cold press. A little bit. Not super ridgy, but yeah. But it gives a nice tone to the pen. Like it gives some more texture than say like a Bristol board. So you'll get, some, like say even on the trees or even on the paper, some of that, those ridges come through. Look real
so
nice.
So you take advantage of the texture. Mm-hmm,
exactly. Because it's such a smooth, like, ink is such a smooth medium. So if you can take advantage of the paper, you can get a lot of cool effects.
That's neat. Okay, mm-hmm. Show us some more.
Okay. Let's see, this one was done last fall. So again, I love anything industrious when it comes to machines mixed with, say, natural elements, like vines.
It looks like, is this a car hidden in the...
Yeah, there's a few of them all hidden in here. One up here.
Oh, I see, yeah.
So I guess you sort of a vine monster of sorts. But...
is the natural world taking over the...
Yeah. Well, there's a book called... The World Without Us. I'd suggest checking it out, but it's what would happen to society and all of our cars, our subways, our buildings, if we weren't here, and how long it would take nature to take it back over, which a lot of kind of like fueled a lot of inspiration for me. So a lot of my work eventually kind of stemmed sort of from that. And I go hiking a lot. I'm always outside. I love to go to abandoned buildings, etc.
Well, you were telling me earlier today... you were telling me earlier today that when you go on a trip, that it takes takes you a while because
like an hour, 2 hour drive will take twice as long.
And why does it take? Why does it take you so long?
There's a lot of cool things on the sides of the roads.
A lot of stuff to see.
Yeah, especially here in Missouri, it's there's so much just left behind on like old farmland or just old buildings, old gas stations and. No one's really watching them. You can just walk in, check them out, be respectful.
Yeah.
But
take plenty of pictures.
Yeah, my
ideas.
Yeah, my girlfriend has gotten to that point where she accepts the fact that if we're gonna drive somewhere, it's gonna take us a while. We're gonna take the back roads.
Start early.
Yeah. Start very early.
Okay, let's see some more. Some of your more your big pieces that you got. How about this one?
Yeah, this one done last fall again. Same. Nat, I love robots.
Hold it in just a little closer.
Sorry.
That's all right.
This one's more of a mixed media piece, but I do love cars and I do love robots, obviously, and anything abandoned. Mm-hmm. So where this one came from, I'm not too sure. It started out as a small drawing and then just kind of branched out.
It really grew.
Yeah, I wanted to practice cars. That was the idea. I just wanted to draw a bunch of cars.
And you did, from all different perspectives and directions.
Right. This one, it started out as... it took a lot of different forms. First, it was a bunch of cars, and there was, like, a building on top. Then I thought the building was kind of overkill. I took it because it kind of took away from, like, the shape, the stacks, the overall composition of the entire piece. And this one, I decided to try a wash of watercolor on the top to give it kind of an atmosphere because everything I do is a lot really stark and white. The other gray kind of made it a little more subtle.
I love what you have going on up in the... Up in the sky area. That's great.
Yeah.
Can you guys see that? Let's pull it in just a little bit more so they can see. Can you see the texture? The camera's reflecting it a little bit. See if I can turn it just a little bit.
It's again, maybe just let like brush texture kind of come through. And the sometimes randomness, like if you stop trying to... I put so much control on all my lines, my grass, the concepts, everything, that sometimes with the natural elements, it's good to let them... have almost a mind of their own. Like, say, the sky, just none of it's controlled at all. It's all just...
let it just do its thing.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see, you brought some other big pieces. Do you want to show any of those?
Yeah.
While we got the camera out.
These two were part of a series of five from college.
You guys can kind of save your questions just for a minute. I'll get back to you guys in just a little bit. So, all the questions that you're putting in, you may need to put them back in the chat again because they're going to get away from me, I'm afraid. So... I will get to them though. I want to show these big pieces first. Okay.
So these were two of a series of five done in college. My last year in the spring. The concept was doing animals, kind of with a kind of personifying animals a little bit and some clothes, whatever.
This is great.
Yeah, these were all actually put on, I designed a fake brewery, and these were the beer labels, and I wanted to actually make the labels by hand originally, so I did a bunch of animals. They eventually got nicknamed the party animals, being part of the beer culture and everything. But I brought these two. This one was also done for a band asked me to do a little design for them, and they were called Fast Astronaut, and that's eventually kind of where this one actually came from. We kind of talked, and I was like, what about an ape? Or, so
the texture you get with the pens is phenomenal.
And this one is actually a collage. So one thing I used to do was I would take ink, I would take cans and paper, and I'd use different inks and papers to kind of layer on top of each other, and it gives it more of a 3D effect, which I know is probably kind of hard to see. But these are all separate pieces, all glued together.
Okay, that's great.
So another one from the series was this guy right here.
And does this guy have a name?
We just called it Hood Rat. So that was the nickname, was Hood Rat. But it's actually a raccoon. But we used this one for a stout style. It was Hood Rat Stout. And so again, I just like the idea of like raccoons kind of wearing, they look like they're wearing masks already.
They do, yeah.
So the ski mask, the whole idea of it. And
so I noticed you don't put irises and pupils in the eyes.
Not a lot. That was the thing I used to do in school a lot.
Kind of your trademark not to have it?
Yeah, well, I had a teacher who got me my start. I almost quit doing art.
Tip it up just a little bit.
I actually almost quit and changed. I was in art education for a while, and I was kind of on the fence of doing. Everyone in my family is a teacher, and my mom's an art teacher, and I was on the fence of going and just doing, you know, something else. And I met one teacher who just completely looked at all the strong points of all my work and said, "You need to focus on this and that, and you know, don't really worry about doing realism. You know, use outlines." And he used outlines, and he also didn't use put pupils in the eyes. So
he didn't.
Yeah, when
or he did.
He didn't.
Didn't.
And I kind of copied him on that. So I'll kind of admit to that.
That's so interesting.
Well,
you
learn. Well, you learn from other people. You always want to learn from other
people.
And it's some people. I mean, it wasn't until after college I kind of realized that there's a fine line between plagiarism and copying other people. Like, if you lift up a whole project versus, like, if you take things from other people and look at what they're doing and why they're doing it and trying to incorporate it into your own concepts.
Yeah, and
you learn so much.
And being influenced by versus, you know, there is a fine line in that, you know.
Yeah, it's take influence and style, but incorporate it to your own. Like, if someone, like with a lot of my work, I looked at the lines and the materials of one artist, and I was like, I love how they shade, I love how they do lines, and I would try to not copy them, but be influenced by them.
Yeah.
And so a lot of old, like, you know, a lot of ink artists is, you know, I just go through, and I have a new artist every month, you know,
that
every couple months
that
I just,
your favorite.
Like,
yeah.
And, you know, at first, you know, it was, when I left school, I was still working really large, and I was doing paintings and drawings, and these, pieces I just showed were, sort of like, they were kind of there, but I tried to venture off and try something else, and then I kind of came back, like, this was the strongest with my style, and sort of moved in that direction and gave up, not necessarily give up painting, but kind of put that in the back seat for a while.
One of the things you guys are going to love here in a minute is you're going to love seeing the broad range of sizes that he does. So I wanted to show you some of his big pieces first while we were sitting like this, and we're going to switch places in a minute, and he's going to show you some of the smaller works that he's done too. Okay, so now I'm looking at the chat. So you guys, I'm going to scroll back and I'm going to interact with you guys just for a second here. And then if you have questions, stick them in the chat, because I'm now concentrating on you guys. One person says, Annette says she wishes she could draw that well. Nice. Wow, beautiful. So they're like, see, I knew they would like what you have to offer.
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah. Petka loves the houses. Wow, so cool. Epic talent. There you go. Well, that was so nice. Much. Great work, Ian. Okay, I'm looking for questions. Miko wants to know if you're on Periscope. Do you do Periscope?
No. I don't know. I need to check it out.
Periscope. Are you on Twitter?
Yeah. It's not, none of my art's on it, though. Okay. I just kind of follow.
Periscope is the broadcasting on Twitter.
Oh, okay. Okay. Okay.
That's Periscope. Nancy loves the trees. Several of them wish that they could do what you're doing. So Barbara says, what a provocative image. Definitely following this artist, envisioning that matted and framed in neutrals, taupe, white, and gray. See, or framed with contrast red matte. So everybody's ideas go off in a different way.
The red, white, and black always look really great.
Hi, Pamela. Okay, Nancy wants to know if you're having a gallery show soon. You should definitely. You're working towards doing some gallery things, aren't you?
Yeah, right now I'm doing a kind of like a larger project. I'm trying to get a book of illustrations together, and when I finally get it done, hopefully in the spring, start doing some galleries and frame everything, scan it.
Great.
Still working on the website gig too. Yep. I don't really have that.
I'm just gonna tell you guys, I keep asking, do you got the website up? Got the website? Yeah. I'm on him.
Hopefully soon.
Let's see, Skinny Cat Creations. I don't think I've seen you before. Welcome. There are two fat cats that live here, but they're not skinny, not one bit. Okay, someone's from Duluth. Do you consider Canal Park when ships are coming in? Do you consider Canal Park? I don't know what that means. When ships are coming in.
I'm not sure.
I'm too ignorant about that one. You're gonna have to spell it out, Margaret. Sorry. Hi, Alice. Okay, we're gonna talk about all the pins and all that. Hi, Krissa. Krissa's in Greece.
Hello.
And okay, so those are pretty much the other things that people ask we're gonna cover here in a second. Okay, so we're going to switch places here so that I can get him under the cameras, and then he's going to actually do some drawing for us, and I'm going to keep pumping him with questions. So I'm going to move the chat computer also, so you guys can funnel questions to me, and I can funnel those to Ian while he's talking. Okay, so I'm just going to switch places with you.
All right.
And a little switch-o change-o, and I'm going to move your drawing so I don't mess anything up here. Sure. So why don't we just show them some of your small pieces before we actually start your drawing. So let me pull this camera in here. And so we'll do that, and then we'll actually get you drawing. How's that?
Sounds good? Sounds good to me.
Okay, so I'll just kind of pull up in here. And so that's what they're seeing there. So you can just kind of, if you need to point at anything, you got pointers. So tell them a little bit about that. And if you want to show anything in detail close up, just tell me. Give me the high sign. Right. We'll use the detail camera.
Sure. This one was actually the first of this entire series, which is why I wanted to show it first. And actually, the inspiration came from in the winter when I was back home for Christmas, there was like a weird, in my dad's backyard, there was a weird vine thing growing, and it was just so cool. I had to take a picture of it. And I kind of incorporated with the idea of working for, you know, I love doing art. Since I left school, I've been working for corporate America at Barnes & Noble, and also I used to work at Verizon. And it was the idea of how I actually felt at that time, you know, working, and how it felt like the overall feeling was to give up and give in to save the man and start working, stop doing what I like doing. And, you know, that kind of fueled this particular piece. You know, that's not the case. I'm not giving up anytime soon.
Why don't you show that? Oh, there's so much detail in that. You can angle it up.
I'll let you. Oh, okay, to that one, yeah.
And that way they can see some of that real detail.
Right. It's so I love shopping carts. I love boxes. I love signs. This actually came from, I live really close to the college campus, and I don't know what it was, but there was a giant head in someone's yard, and it was just busted to pieces. It was a plastic one. It was like a mannequin almost, but it was huge. It's like it was the size of this desk, and wow. I just thought it was so interesting that it was there. I took another photo of it, and I incorporated into this piece. It's kind of like a symbol.
So a lot of your work is really symbolic.
Yeah, it all comes from, say, the world around me, mm-hmm. People that I meet, stories that I hear, places I go, mm-hmm. Overall feelings. So I would say, like, real life would be my concept and trying to, make sense of a lot of these.
And what's the substrate you're working on here?
The paper?
Yeah.
It's mixed media paper, Strathmore. Okay. I actually have the book right here. So I'll just show it right here. So Strathmore mixed media. Yeah.
That was my bad.
No, okay.
I'm manning the cameras, people, and he's trying to keep up with me. So any bad camera work is Barb's fault, not Ian's fault. Yeah.
So Strathmore. At this size, I like to work on a Strathmore mixed media paper.
And this is 5.5 by 8.5. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it again, it doesn't have much texture like on the watercolor paper, mm-hmm. But you do get some good tones, and it does work well with the ink. On my sketchbook, the smaller drawings are just regular sketch paper. Mm-hmm. Again, they just look
okay. You've got to show those close up over there to that other camera.
Yeah.
So I'll hold it up here. Because that way they can see, because that is so, they're so tiny. They're so little, you guys.
So, yeah.
Look at that amount of detail.
So it's, again, just with these pens, I know someone asked earlier, I use Zebra pens. You can buy them pretty much anywhere. Any office supply store has them. It's like maybe $3 or $4 for a pack of two.
Here, maybe we can get that. Can you see, get the light to catch it. It says Zebra.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a Bic product?
It's not a Bic product. Zebra is actually the company, but it's a ballpoint pen.
Ballpoint.
They're pretty cheap. I mean, $3 or $4 for a pack of two. You can go and buy like Faber-Castell or Micron pens, mm-hmm. but you can get some good detail. And
And the ballpoint doesn't clog up like some of the felt tips do sometimes.
Some of these will bleed out a little mm-hmm. bit. You'll get some like dark spots that come through. But you can learn to control that if you're, say, on an outline. If you mm-hmm. press just a little bit harder when you're on an outline, some of that will bleed out, and then you can go back to shading. So sometimes that just adds more texture.
Yeah.
If you learn to just make some mistakes. Like, a few spots that, I could point out where the pen probably did bleed out. Like, let me see if I can see it up on that screen.
Mm-hmm.
Like, right here, or, like, right there.
Okay, you can see where. Okay, right in here?
Yeah, you can see where the pen got a little bit darker, but, uh-huh. There's so much detail, and, it doesn't really matter. No. And also, it's an abandoned building. It's going to look a little rickety.
Yeah. Do you do any blending with anything else, or is it all just the stroke of the pen?
It's mostly just the pen. Mm-hmm. Really, if you focus, I focus a lot on the lines. Mm-hmm. And when you... whenever I was in school, I had a friend who I shared a studio with, and we had like studio cubicles,
mm-hmm.
and what he told me one day was, and it stuck with me ever since, and it was a huge game changer, was all your darks will bring out your lights, and all mm-hmm. your lights will bring out your darks, so the darker mm-hmm. you get, the lighter other things will seem, mm-hmm. and the lighter things seem, the darker things seem.
Uh-huh.
So, I'll go in with black, and I'll establish a black or a dark blue or
mm-hmm.
whatever. And then from there, the rest just kind of vibrates and just comes out. Mm-hmm. And I do a lot of kind of the same things, like houses, mm-hmm. A lot of nature, characters.
And then the color that you're adding here and there, that's all put in with highlighters?
A lot of either colored pencil or highlighter, because they do have a little more of a smoother finish than, mm-hmm. say, like a lot of paints.
Mm-hmm.
I'll use watercolor because, again, like ink and watercolor, like like soulmates.
Yeah.
Almost, when it comes to the illustration, they always will always look good. Even if you just splash watercolor on top of something.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. There's some drawings I'm skipping over here just because
they're fine. You show us whatever you want to show us.
When I didn't have my car broke down, I was waiting on the bus. I was doing a lot of sketch journals when it was like 0 degrees outside. So they're not too impressive because my hand was shivering at the same time. But again, I've kind of moved to, with these little journals, I love doing just the houses.
I love your, I'm assuming this is water, is it?
It can be water, it can be whatever really you want it to be. It
was more just kind of an interesting suggestion of water.
Just kind of I like the whole floating island aspect of things. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I just try to change it up at the bottom. So really it was just kind of more of like a surreal sort of touch or vision for that matter. This is one of the ones that were shown on the Instagram. But
move it over just a little bit.
I'll let you control it.
There you go.
So again, like I said about making mistakes, and I never use pencil with this particular book. I like to go straight in with pen, and it's kind of like a good exercise to learn how to make mistakes and work around mistakes. And obviously, I made a huge mistake up here, but I just figured out a way to blend it all together.
Okay, now you say, obviously, you made a huge mistake.
Well, a lot of people may not be.
It's not obvious to us.
But yeah, I did mess up. Up here, and how am I going to make this look all right? And again, I actually used some to bring out some shadows. I used a black pen, added it to here just to make it darker, add some shadow. And shadows are beautiful because you can actually cover up a lot of mistakes or different things with shadow, and you can also say a lot with shadow. Mm-hmm. It can be very expressive.
I love your intense contrast on this between the lights and then, you know, where you say was a mistake, but that incredible dark.
It kind of pushes things out.
Yeah, I love that.
So, yeah, the illusion of space really comes through with whenever you can use shadows. I haven't completely mastered shadows. It's something that I try to work on with every single piece because it used to scare me throughout schools, heavy darks.
Yeah. Yeah, I understand that.
Yeah.
Okay, you show us anything else you want.
Yeah, it's again, just keep on going. That's actually the last one in this one. But,
I love the look of the abandoned quality and the sci-fi sort of thing that you blend together.
I like to... So I'm really inspired by a lot of... some of the darker, like, say, movies or everything that was Tim Burton or whatever was so. When I was a kid, I grew up loving Nightmare Before Christmas. And my mom always pushed a lot of that artwork towards me and was like, you know, it's okay to have fun, you know, make things weird. Like, you know, and also, like, say, when I got to school, I was really scared to express myself because I'm like, oh, I'm being judged right now, you know. And then you get over it.
We're all being judged,
right? You get over that, and you're just like, I don't really care what they think. I just want to make artwork, and
that's right.
And sometimes, eventually, it became the shock factor. I was doing some really crazy work just to get a little bit of a shock factor out of some of my fellow students that were there with me, and so I went through a phase of. Doing nothing but like, you know, Michelangelo inspired things, like Renaissance inspired things. So it was a lot of angels and skeletons and it was very dark, and it was fun, and it got me it was a huge start.
That's great.
To kind of be like, oh, kind of coming out of the box.
Well, why don't you bring in your piece that you're going to work on there?
Yeah.
And now I'm going to let you tell me which place is going to be the most comfortable for you to work.
Yeah, I'll have to get a feel for it here.
Yeah, so you get to decide. Is there anything else you want to show?
I guess I could show, like, the different papers before we totally get in.
Sure.
Besides the small journal, a lot of sketches will start out in just your moleskin.
And you can scoot over and make yourself comfortable.
Yeah, totally. Your moleskin journal here. I'm trying to find a good
spot.
They
all know about moleskins.
Okay. Oh, yeah. I'm a huge fan of moleskin just because, one, I love the cream color of the paper.
And this is a moleskin sketch, right?
Yes. Yeah. This is, again, I go straight in with, like with any of my sketchbooks, I go straight in with pen and I let the mistakes just happen and work around them and just really have fun with it. And I just, again, try new things. So, this is actually a building in Springfield, Illinois that I just kind of modified a little bit, but I thought it was just such an interesting little thing that I had to do something with it. But, again, just let it grow. It's like, it's all fiction. Mm-hmm. So you got to have fun with it and stop trying to make things real, you know, embrace surreal. Again, a lot of little characters. So I need to flip to some of my favorite ones. So this is where, these are more of my favorite ones here, is when I started using kind of the double spread. Mm-hmm. But every for me anyway, and maybe for a lot of other people, different papers, different books, different materials make you want to draw certain things or do certain things. And your style will look a little bit different, even slightly.
So you said you work directly with ink in here.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So straight in with ink.
Ballpoint?
Yep. Same pens.
Same pens.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Occasionally I'll use like Micron or Faber-Castell pens. Mm-hmm. But, so yeah, it's kind of hard to see all the detail on all of them, but it's,
But there's something kind of really cool about seeing it in a computer monitor and you get to see that, you know.
Yeah. It's like, I'm just up here trying to like make it all straight. I don't know. It's different. Yeah.
Yeah. But it's just fun to see it in, you know, the two page.
Yeah.
On the screen where you get to see the overview, I guess, you know?
Yeah. It's cool. It's different cause I don't really look at it on a computer screen. Mm-hmm. A lot of things I just take pictures with my phone.
Oh, that's a cool thing. That's so cool. I like that.
Yeah, I was really fascinated by those these dragons for a little while. I want to kind of go back to this concept. I've kind of moved on. So I designed this for a friend. I actually ended up drawing this on her computer, and it turned out really pretty cool.
Wow.
So we're coming here to an end. Yeah, this one.
Oh my goodness! Now that had to take a while.
Yeah, this one did take a solid week of coming home from work and drawing some grass, drawing some trees. Again, I'm really into robots and really strange characters. This is a little bit of both, but this was kind of the first machine drawing that I did, and from there I started drawing all these weird crazy machines that don't make a whole lot of sense, but that's kind of the idea.
And they don't have to.
They don't have to, exactly. Yeah. That was the idea. So yeah, this one is still, out of all my sketchbook pieces, still one of my favorites that I've personally done. And then I got really into the house concepts, having houses with personalities, trying to say something.
The detail that you capture at this size is just amazing to me. Amazing.
Yeah. So, and then again, like,
what size is the pen point? Is it a fine
point? It's a fine tip, yeah. I can't really,
That just doesn't seem like it's that fine to me.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's you can really, really get some detail and get some tone out of these, but I'll show you one more before we start. But, this was the last of it. Based on an old band from Springfield, Illinois, they had an album called Building a Better, and it was just like kind of a Mad Libs kind of idea, but I just thought it was an interesting concept, so.
We had a question that one of the viewers wanted to know if you had family in Springfield, Illinois.
I'm actually from Jacksonville, Illinois, so it's I don't have much family in Springfield. A lot of my friends still live there, but I'm from Jacksonville, Illinois originally. So if you've ever been, I think it's to the west. Have you ever been that way?
You want to show them this real quick before you get started?
Yeah, and this will be the real last.
Because you don't always work in sketchbooks.
No. Lately at work, we have a whole bunch of, here we go. We have a bunch of these blank coffee sleeves that showed up, so I've been using just Sharpie marker and making little doodles on these blank coffee sleeves. And this is actually I was asked to do a mural at one of the local tap houses here in Columbia called ITAP. It's an international tap house. And we've been kind of throwing ideas back and forth of what we wanted. And so this is a little bit of a concept drawing of where we're going to go with this mural. And the space of the wall is kind of like the coffee sleeve, where it's really long and really short.
So how long is it?
I don't know the specifics. Yeah. I look at the wall. I go in there like a couple times a week
and you go,
to like
that's
look
really
at it.
And big.
Say, yeah, it's very big. Yeah. And so it's going to be a big challenge, but we're all excited about it. And this is sort of like the first idea that we have is this this beer machine, like where all the beer ingredients and the hops are going in through a grinder and going through all the tubes and the tanks. And then eventually at the end, it's just pouring a beer. So
that's going to be really fun.
I think it's going to be fun. So yeah. Hands and feet working the machines. Yeah. And so that's I'm very excited about it.
Okay. So why don't you show them what you got? You kind of did a sketch already.
Yeah. Last night.
Can you tell me where you want to work, where it's comfortable?
This will probably work out. Most things
straight to the world, maybe.
Like I kind of where things sort of start.
Is that going to work?
Right,
for
yeah,
you?
This will work. Okay. As long as it works for everyone else.
Okay.
Things start out with these smaller ones when I'm really trying to do something new. It'll start out as kind of like, say, a basic pencil sketch. I'll just generalize everything and then go back in and fill in the details.
So that's what you have here is a pencil sketch.
Yep. Okay. Yeah. So with this paper and anything larger, so anything like larger than the Moleskin sketchbook, mm-hmm. I'll go in with pencil. And that's when I'm trying new things.
And this one is the mixed media?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay.
So a couple other drawings I'm working with right now, again, like they're just, I'll go back in and I'll find things to throw in there. Mm-hmm. And some take longer than others. And this is the one I'm currently working with at home.
So this is partly, mostly pencil yet, and then some pen.
You can see where kind of the ink comes in, mm-hmm. and you add the shading and the textures, mm-hmm. and a lot of things are random. Like, things will pop up. Like, mm-hmm. I don't know why this circle's here or what I'm going to do with this circle, but it'll eventually become something.
Do you, when you're approaching a piece like this, are you being concerned about where the light source is coming from and that kind of stuff? Or are you just kind of going with treating each piece individually?
I go in focusing on, I'll establish, say, the first line or the first mark and build off there. Mm-hmm. And if that first mark is kind of like a thicker one, mm-hmm. I'll have the shadows coming, say, from
say, okay,
either
that's
side.
Where it's coming from.
Yeah, so that all comes, it's kind of like an afterthought almost. It'll just evolve mm-hmm. within itself.
Yeah. Okay, why don't you start inking for us so they can see some of the lines develop.
So, yeah, this is the one that last night. So, again, like I said, like I pick like whatever, wherever to start. It's random. And mm-hmm. sometimes that first line is always the hardest to decide. So
if you want to work here or if you want to change positions, you tell me and we'll do whatever.
Yeah. And if anyone has any problem, like sometimes I cover up things.
That's all right. You just work. I'm going to just ask questions while you just randomly work on stuff.
Yeah. So again, just start out and just kind of like let it grow, and you can add the detail coming through. I haven't really drawn in front of people before, so
that's
it's kind
right.
of like a
it's a little nerve-wracking. I know.
It's a little surreal experience.
Yeah, I know. So you can only you know, you don't have to do the whole thing by any means. You can just do a little piece of it or whatever.
Yeah, no problem. So I got time, so we'll just see how it goes. So again, like we'll establish where a shadow is and make the line just a little bit darker.
And it looks like you're using a really light touch with the pen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Because that idea is just so if there is, say, some type of error, you don't go totally black.
Yeah,
first.
You don't.
Yeah.
Paint yourself into a corner, basically.
Right, and then that's when you have to break out the other materials, say like watercolors or markers or ink mm-hmm. or something, because mm-hmm. I've messed up before, and I'll bring in marker or whatever, and it'll end up looking good, but at the same time, it wasn't the idea you had mm-hmm. going in. But that's mm-hmm. kind of the beauty of art is you know, it's imperfect.
Adapting.
Mm-hmm, adapting, mm-hmm. and everything is going to be a little imperfect. Mm-hmm. So it's just learning to love it.
So when you went to school, did you actually study? You actually studied art in school.
I studied graphic design, actually.
Graphic design.
But I did not really like graphic design. It's nothing against it, but when I got out of school and I was trying to be a graphic designer, I had too much. I wanted too much creative control for that industry. Mm-hmm. So I was partially working for a iPhone company who were making iPhone apps. And that company, I think, has dissolved since mm-hmm. I was there. But anyway, they were constantly, like, asking me to do characters, do this and mm-hmm. that. And I had my own style, and it just wasn't...
You weren't blending.
It wasn't... Yeah, I couldn't adapt to what mm-hmm. they wanted me to do, because everything would be, like, you know, this. And they wanted these, like,
Let's
little cute characters.
Let's try the other camera, just for...
Yeah.
Let me see if I can...
Yeah, no problem.
Can you work at that angle, or is that not work for you?
Oh, that works. Yeah, that works for me.
Okay.
Might have to like turn just a little bit.
That's fine. You put your in your left hand. Can you move your left hand over just a little bit?
Yeah. Is that good?
Cool. Yeah. If you can do that, then they can see a little bit more of the detail.
Yeah.
Yeah. That way, maybe they can see a little bit more of how you're moving the pen and so forth.
Yeah, it's like, again, the light, like we said earlier, the light touch is really, really key.
Yeah.
If you can learn to control how much pressure mm-hmm. you have with it, that makes all the difference when it comes to the actual detail.
So is graphic design, is that more bringing to life what other people,
not
other people's concepts?
I would say... I think if you're established in that industry, you mm-hmm. can do more of have a little bit more fun.
Mm-hmm.
For the most part, starting out, you're just doing logos and you're doing a lot of grunt work.
Mm.
And it's I just wasn't.
Doesn't sound very expressive.
It wasn't. It wasn't exactly what I thought it was going to be.
Mm-hmm.
And I would just work for. I'd work from home. I moved to Columbia, and then I was working from home, and I was working maybe 8 or 9 hour days doing design work, sitting at the computer all day.
Mm.
And then I was just so burned out creatively that I couldn't do my own work. So I decided to go just get a job somewhere that I didn't have to do artwork all day or do someone else's artwork all day. And it did help out a lot. And I actually started working at Verizon. And like I told you earlier when we were chatting, nobody has Verizon around here. So
yeah.
I'd go a whole day without seeing one customer.
Mm-hmm.
And so that gave me a lot of time to bring my own artwork to work with me. And then also to bring my sketchbook. And so while, you know, everyone else was kind of just sitting bored, and I was just doing all my artwork, and eventually I just kind of known that I was going to be doing artwork in the corner and they would take all the customers. So it was kind of a fun little gig.
So you got to get paid and do your art.
Exactly. And
that's kind of nice.
That's what my mom would say too. Mm-hmm. And she would call me and be like, what'd you do today? Well, I was at work and I just drew for 8 hours. So
yeah.
You're getting paid to do your artwork. So
there
I mean, that's something. It's like, yeah, I guess, I don't know if I've made it, but you know, it's definitely something.
So, where did you go to school?
I went to Southern Illinois in Carbondale.
Carbondale, Illinois.
Yeah, and it's if anyone wants to know where a really good art school is, that is definitely, if you really tap in to the teachers and everything, it's a really wonderful art program. They have a great, it's underrated for sure in the art. For schools that mm-hmm. are known for art, a lot of people always want to go to Columbia in Chicago or Art Institute of Chicago or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
They feel like they need to go somewhere exotic where there is a huge art scene, which mm-hmm. isn't necessarily not true. But my hand's in
That's
the way.
That's okay. That's all right.
I get into a habit. But yeah, if you really just look at certain programs in some of these smaller schools, we have We have really great programs everywhere you go.
One of the viewers says that her son went to that school for graphic arts.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. What year did he graduate?
What year did he graduate, Carol? And Ian says, so that pen is a ballpoint. Yes, it is, Ian. We have another Ian. He's in the UK.
Okay. And like, say we're doing like a wood texture here, just kind of go back in with a light line, and it gives the illusion of, say, like boards or whatever. You know, I'll show that a million times.
You have definitely mastered using a ballpoint pen, my friend. Yeah, I'm not kidding.
That's all I used for a year or two. When I left school, it was the cheapest. You know, I couldn't really afford art supplies.
Exactly.
So I had to make do, and I had a friend. I was telling you earlier, I had a friend who all he used was ballpoint pens in school, and it blew my mind the first time I saw it. But then when I sat down and actually used it, you realize how powerful it is as an illustration tool. And it was just a game changer. I never looked back. And, you know, I might go and explore other mediums soon. But until then, I'm going to stick with the ballpoint for now.
She said that he's 42 now. So but she said he was very impressed with the school.
Yeah, it's a great school. Any people that are trying to go into the creative field, I always tell them to check out Carbondale. And I have a lot of friends who ended up going to grad school from Carbondale. And even the people who were graphic designers went on to be very successful. I have one friend who his first job outside of design that I worked with him at the local newspaper there, the school newspaper. His first gig was at doing graphic design for Disney.
Oh, wow. That's a pretty good first gig.
Yeah, and he loved graphic design. He loved locals. He loved doing logos and anything, and he was very involved. And but he loved working for them. He had a little internship, and it was paid. And now I think he works for Disney owns a coffee shop down there.
Oh, really?
Or a coffee brand, and he does all their designs. And his wife does all the graphic design for Outback Steakhouse, I'm pretty sure. There's a lot of people with a lot of connections there. Mm-hmm. It's a very underrated school.
Mm-hmm. So what, as you think back, what's your earliest creative memory that you can think of?
Like I said, I mentioned it earlier, my mom was a art teacher. And if it wasn't, her, I have a twin brother, if it wasn't her bringing us to her classroom and just giving us paper and just being like, and paint, she's just like, go crazy, do whatever you want.
So was she doing that to keep you out of her hair? Probably. Was she doing that to get you to express yourself?
I think it was a little bit of both, because my dad also did art as well. So they were very, very much, they wanted John and I both to be involved with art or have at least a little bit of an education when it came to understanding the arts. So it's a little bit of both, I would say. And my dad, you know, my parents split pretty early. And my dad, when I was at his house, he had this big old dining room table. And he would, bring out, markers and pastels and giant sheets of paper.
So he was an artist also.
Yeah. He's a civil draftsman, but he originally drew the most beautiful architectural buildings, which is where I kind of got it. I'd see him draw these buildings, and then I was like, I really want to do that. And some of his work is actually up on my Instagram. It's the ones that don't have like 50 stories, you know, and are stacked on top of trailers. But he drew beautifully, and my mom was more of an impressionist painter. And
now she teaches still.
She's retired. Yeah, she taught at the deaf school for, I don't even know, it was a long time, probably 28 to 30 years.
Does she still practice her art?
Yeah, she just actually bought a new house, and she has an art studio like this one in the house, and she's all excited, like, oh, I have room to do all this crazy artwork now. And she's like, I'm so excited that she's finally going to be back into it.
What does she like to do the most? Like?
She likes pastels lately, it seems, and she works a lot with clay. So she goes through phases. It'll be like clay, it'll be pastels, it'll be paint, and then she
sounds like the rest of us.
Yeah, she loves Art Nouveau. Art Nouveau and Art Deco are her absolute favorite things. And it's like Klimt and all those artists are people that she draws a lot of inspiration from, and she's very eclectic, and it just makes sense, and all of her work is just absolutely, it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. So I always had a lot of support from my parents to kind of pursue art, and then, you know, when I told them in school when I changed from art education, you know, I told them why, and they fully, I thought they were going to kind of disapprove, because I'm like, well, I may not get a, you know, a steady full-time, you know, paying job. Right. You know, I might be working as a barista or you know, attending bar.
So.
And they were supportive. They're like, you know what? And they still want me to go back, and I might still go back and be an art teacher eventually. But until then, I'm just kind of exploring my own avenue.
So we have a question for you.
Yeah.
Do you use the Rotring Isograph pens? Do you know what those are?
No, I've never used those.
No, never used those.
Are those like Rapidograph pens or whatever they're called?
Okay, that's a question from Ian Jackson. And Ian, can you give us any more information about that pen? Is it a Rapidograph pen? Neither one of us have much knowledge about that.
I love pens, but you know, it's I'm not sure if I've heard of that one or not.
Yeah. So let's see. Okay, I think I know the answer to this question. Okay, Ian says it may be a Rapidograph. I'm not sure. Neither one of us are sure on that one.
Because a lot of architects use those, I know. Yeah. They're super fine tip, but, you know, again, like I...
Are they ones you have to fill?
Yeah, you have to fill those. And I heard they break all the time. It just seemed like a headache that I didn't... With these, I can
These are cheaper.
Yeah, these, and you can actually... if you really want to get rid of them, you can recycle the... They completely come apart. You can recycle the metal if you really want to. And... you can actually, they come apart super, super easy too.
Do you refill them?
You can if you want, but they're cheap enough to just buy new ones. They're like $3 or $4 for two of them. You know, if you lose one, it's not a huge heartbreak.
Right. That's true. That is true.
Because I'm
if somebody steals your bag of pens.
Yeah. I'm really bad about losing pens. So, again, the cheaper, the better.
Yeah. So I think I know the answer to this question, but do you have a favorite art supply?
I would say pens, watercolors, for sure.
Do you find that your favorites change over time?
Yeah, but the thing is, like, a lot of my favorite artists aren't pen and ink artists.
That's interesting.
I look at a lot of painters, and if you look at, say, some of your favorite painters or whatever, you can kind of see where, say, a pen and ink drawing would kind of emulate some of their work. It's all like drawing is and painting, it's all the same thing at the end of the day, just how you layer things on top of each other, where you go about things, and it's all mark making as well. So if you really, really look at a painting closely, you can see where the different shades are blended together, just like if you had a pen.
So when you were in school, I'm assuming you had to learn or do classes in all the different kinds of mediums. Would that be correct?
Yeah.
Acrylic and watercolor and gouache and whatever.
Since I was in graphic design, I was required to take one or, like, you know, some basic core art classes. But beyond that, we weren't completely required because we weren't technically, like, art students. We were design students. So the rest, there were some core classes, like we took like printmaking and, you know, drawing one and two. Mm-hmm. And then after some of those, it was like, you know, some of your basic composition classes. after that, it was all up to you. If you really, really wanted to take those classes, you could. It was recommended, but you didn't have to. But I, of course, was just like, I'm taking all of them.
Yeah.
If mm-hmm. I can. And I even went and took some of like the advanced like drawing classes mm-hmm. were with all the drawing and painting students, and they're like, why are you a graphic designer? Yeah. Why are you here?
What are
like,
you well,
I don't
doing
really
here?
I don't really want to be a graphic designer. It's
So since you didn't want to be a graphic designer, how did you land in graphic design?
For like, well, I talked to them and, you know, they were like, you know, you get to take all the art classes and you, and design is kind of a broad field. Mm-hmm. It goes from, you know, poster design to, you know, there's a lot of things like I love beer labels.
Maybe a broad range.
Yeah, it's a broad range of things and it looks really great on paper when you're looking for a job. Like it's a little more lucrative than say a painting degree, which is what I really wanted. But I guess it was just that if I do want a job doing something creative, it would be a lot easier to get a graphic design job than like a painting job.
Right, true.
So that was like the whole philosophy behind it. And so still, I do like to do graphic design every once in a while, but I rarely have time to sit down and do like logos.
Or... Hang on, everybody. Yes, wake up, computer. Sorry, I thought I had that fixed. I think I got myself waylaid. Hang on a second, everybody. Let me change a setting here. My bad. I got off track earlier. So if you saw a black screen, it won't last but a second. So I'm seeing houses. These are bird houses.
Yeah, I've been on a big birdhouse kick lately. Uh-huh. I think it's the whole spring thing.
Yeah. And what else? What is the other character? I'm not seeing what...
It's actually a follow-up of another drawing that I did that I'll show real quick.
Okay.
So I did another drawing just inspired by the weather here is very... you know, hot and cold, especially in the winter. It'll be 70 it'll be 70 degree. Yeah, it'll be 70 degrees one day, then it'll be 0 degrees the next day, mm-hmm. and then it'll be raining, then snowing, then mm-hmm.
You don't like it today, wait till tomorrow.
Yeah, that whole philosophy. And it's just really trying to understand a lot of the weather. So this one's actually when we were kind of talking about spring at the coffee shop and doing kind of a spring inspired drawing. The idea was, it was actually a follow-up to this one here.
Okay.
So I used the same character.
Okay, over here.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Same character, same sort of concepts.
Okay, hold it over here just a little bit more.
Yeah, same character.
So the same character mm-hmm. as what we have here.
Right. But, you know, kind of a little bit different.
Uh-huh.
Because sometimes when you do the same, maybe the same drawing a couple of times, different things come about.
I mean, you have to look at what you're doing. I mean, the viewer I'm talking to. Because at first, I didn't even see this little character.
A little garden gnome. Yeah, wizard, I didn't even see. Wizard guy.
Yeah. I love the clouds, the rain, the birdhouse. That is really fun. And who is this guy up here at the top?
It's actually the... mascot for, or the logo for Big Boy, you know, the statues.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we can kind of go, like I said, like before, I like to pick out different symbols mm-hmm. and incorporate them all, like from the weather to the mm-hmm. character and everything. And just trying to understand where, what controls the weather.
This.
It's like, maybe it is Big Boy.
Yeah. I love this with the clouds.
Yeah. The two-dimensional. Mm-hmm. When I was in high school, I did a lot of really flat cartoon like mm-hmm. art. So I've been trying to like say with the third dimension, try mm-hmm. to incorporate some of those flat drawings that I mm-hmm. used to do, and just kind of revise them. Mm-hmm. So I like the idea that it's more of like a stage prop.
Yeah.
Then,
yeah.
So sort of like everything's not totally real here.
Yeah.
So I like it's kind of I guess it's a little chaotic, but it's they're fun to do.
Well, the cool part about it is that you just like one of the viewers said, the more you look at it, the more you see, and it's so true.
Right.
So.
And I always like that about doing art is having people be able to, you know, look at it for a long period of time, because there's a lot of times I go to a gallery showing and I take one glance and feel like, okay, I've seen it all.
Right.
And I like to hide things or write things mm-hmm. or do something else.
Do you incorporate words into your work very much?
Or
messages, blatant written messages.
Yeah, yeah. Like a lot of times on the houses, I'll do that, or like the first piece that I showed about the give up, give in, kind of like give maybe some people an idea of where to start with what the heck any of this means, because maybe to some people it's just a bunch of stuff thrown together. So sometimes it's good to kind of clue people in just a little bit. So, yeah, and sometimes you can get kind of a different feeling whenever something's written on there where maybe someone who's not as sensitive to concepts or different art, maybe it'll clue them in and make them feel something because it's just written there.
Sometimes some of us just need a clue.
Right, exactly. Like sometimes it's so obscure that you just need a clue.
Yeah.
So again, I do enjoy trying to like clue people into maybe where I started, where I'm going with all of this.
So where are you going now? Now that we've got birdhouses, where would you go? How would you approach it next? Do you have a plan?
Yeah, I like to jump around a little bit. At this point, I'll probably, now that there's some, lines and some tone established, I'll probably jump forward.
Okay.
To get the foreground so that doesn't get covered up completely. Mm. Because ink is pretty unforgiving.
Because it is ink.
Yeah, it's a very unforgiving material. So you gotta kind of think, think very strategically whenever you start.
I really hadn't thought about that, but
yeah, I picked the birdhouses to go first because it kind of is random, but it's also they kind of sit alone. There's nothing that's going to be in front of them, so I can do that. And I always like to do the characters kind of last because sometimes it's not that I don't like this character, but I may get a better idea eventually and redraw him. So a lot of the pieces I do, it'll start out with an original figure, but then I'll move in and just completely change it up. Like I said, I like to come to the foreground and maybe just establish some grass, some more natural aspects of things. And I draw grass really weird. So, sometimes it's patchy, sometimes it's thick, whatever.
It's your grass.
Right. And shadows are also key with grass to kind of make it look, give it some volume. And I also had people who told me, you don't have to draw every blade of grass. Yeah. And I also told them to go away.
You said, leave me alone.
Yeah, don't tell me how to draw my grass.
I will draw grass the way I want to draw it, right? It's my grass. I can draw it the way I want.
Right. It's like, if I want to draw every blade of grass, I can draw every blade of grass, which I'm not going to do on camera because I know that's going to be kind of boring, but I just want to kind of give you an idea where it all starts. And then eventually, you can just fill in with blacks and do the same, a pattern. It's more of a pattern. A lot of ink is learning to draw patterns. So the grass
Here's another question for you. Are you familiar with the art in a game named, I'm going to spell it because I don't know how to say it, M-A-C-H-A-N-A-R-I-U-M, Machinarium?
I don't think so.
You see that? That's the word.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with that?
I'm not.
Okay. No, he doesn't. The art is by Amanita Design. You ever heard of that?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
I'll have to check him out.
Nope. Not familiar. Okay, and here's another question. Ian Jackson wants to know, do you work from left to right?
I like to, it kind of sort of flows that way, but then I kind of jump around and then eventually, I like to look at it, strategically in terms of different areas.
Do you have trouble smearing if you lay your hand on the work?
I'll draw with fingerless gloves on, depending on the size of the drawing. Okay. And that keeps any oils from your hands or sweat or whatever from soaking in and yellowing the paper.
Had not thought of that.
And it keeps things from smearing. that I forgot it today. I was busy grabbing all the work, and then I got here.
You need paper or something to put on there. I've got deli wrap and stuff like that. If you need it for anything.
You know, I don't always use it, but it is one of the things
that makes a lot of sense.
I do like to use it.
Fingerless gloves.
Mm-hmm. And also, it kind of makes so when you're drawing lines, like your hand doesn't stick. You can draw a straighter line.
Right. That's another good point.
Yeah. So I started.
Because otherwise,
that.
You get those little. little unpredictable jogs in the line.
Yeah, normally that's kind of what I do is just do like little bits of line and then kind of piece them all together. But it just kind of depends on, you know, the circumstance and what the art calls for.
And what mood you're in.
Yeah, exactly.
Someone wants to know if you're using, do you know if that ink is a gel ink or if it's just a regular?
I think it's just a regular ink. Yeah, it's not a gel ink.
So we think it's a regular ballpoint ink.
Yeah. I just saw another artist using it and I was like, well, I'm going to start. Well, I started buying them because of class and then I saw another artist using them and I was like, well, I'm going to just try to do a whole drawing with one. It was just, it made everything. I just love the way that it looked. I loved how it made my style look, and I just kind of stuck with it. And it's not that I haven't wanted to move on, but it's just like I'm just enjoying it too much to move on right now.
Oh, but I think that that's such a cool thing that you... I tend to jump from thing to thing to thing, and I think it's really neat that you're going after one medium, so exploring it so much, you know?
Yeah.
If I would do that more, I would master things a little bit better.
Yeah. Again, there's a book called by I think his name's Austin Kleon. He's the guy who did like the blackout poetry book with the newspapers.
Oh yeah.
He wrote he wrote a book called Steal Like an Artist. And it's all about...
I've heard of that.
Yeah, it's a really wonderful book, and you learn more and more and more about, you know, developing your own style. And one of the things that I was doing when I left school was, you know, like, one day I wanted to be a painter, one day I wanted to be an illustrator, one day I wanted to be a designer, and it just jumped around so much. And then when I read that book, one of the chapters is all about, you know, find two artists that you like and you want to be like and look at them and study from them instead of picking a million different people. And so for a while, I looked at the same artists that I really liked and just stuck with what they were doing. And, you know, kind of getting out of people have the idea that, you know, you're supposed to keep everything secret, your style, and how you do things. And I feel like in the modern age now, it's like what he says is people want to know process. They want to know where you're getting your ideas.
And let's face it, not much is secret
anymore. And it's like, and there's no fun in that. You know, it's like, I love to share my ideas and concepts and processes. And, you know, sometimes like there's certain like pieces like I wouldn't, you know, go out and be like, oh yeah, this is finalized, but you know, it's like it's a work in progress, and you know, obviously people can see that, but
or not sometimes, and we don't see it sometimes. We look at it and go, that is so cool, and then you see it. Sometimes you've shown me some of your pieces that were in progress and to me it looks finished, and then you show it to me again later when it is finished. You go, oh yeah, now I see it, because the concept was, it was your concept. You had to give birth to the whole thing, you know?
And a lot of times, like, say some of these concepts, like, this looks like this right now, but down the road, I mean, once I get a little closer to finalizing something, it may completely change up and be a completely different piece
than it is right now.
Yeah, like, a lot of these, like, I'll, say, have maybe a source photograph or just a basic idea. This was just, I just started sketching it, and this is what came out. But, you know, we had, like, kind of a concept of doing something more spring-like.
So, just rough ballpark, do you have any idea what time it will take you to finish inking this?
I think if, I definitely probably won't finish it during the show.
Right.
But I would say by the end of the day, I'll at least have half of it done. That's like, I like to get up and, like you said, you know, decompress, go somewhere else. Like, I'll probably go to a coffee, you know, when I leave here, I might go to a coffee shop, and then I might go to the place that I'm doing the mural at, I like to go there. And the reason they asked me to do the mural is that I bring my artwork there, and I'll sit and I'll drink a beer and, you know, zone out for a while and just do artwork. And that's how this whole project came to be. But I've been going there for nearly 2 or 2.5 years. And so I love going there, and it's just something about the environment, the action, the chaos that's going on around you, people talking, music playing. I can just, I have ADD really bad, and it just helps me focus.
Well, and it's really interesting how some places are so much more conducive to creativity, I find. I mean, several years ago, I wrote a book, and one of the places where I did a lot of that writing was sitting in the cafe at Barnes & Noble. And because the chaos of people talking and, you know, doing whatever they do, there was something about that that it worked for me. It was a creative kind of space for me. Now there's a lot of stuff I could not do that. I could not go over there and do that, but it's just interesting how different places will sort of open you up, you know, for lack of a better term.
And there's like a comfort aspect too, where you're, I don't know, like if I feel like I can sit there and not be disturbed, while all that's going on is great. So yeah, there's not many places, but I found the ones that I like, and I do bounce around on my day off.
You have to. Otherwise, people know that you go to the same place, and then they wait for you to come, right?
Right. I hope I don't have any stalkers like that. Yeah, but, you know, if...
They don't even mean to be.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, so here's another question for you. Do you consider the type of paper and weight of paper for each of your different artworks?
Yeah, it depends. Whenever I work larger, one of the pieces I showed earlier, I love to work on watercolor because everything's a little bit bigger and some of that extra texture will come through that if it was a little bit larger, it might not exist if I use, say, the same mixed media or Bristol board.
So bigger pieces, you're more apt to use watercolor paper.
Yeah.
Smaller pieces, you tend to work more in the mixed media. Do you use your sketchbook paper for finished works, or are these just considered sketches?
Yeah, and mostly, I mean, they're pretty much finished drawings, but, you know, I don't know, there's something about that size of paper that... it's just ideas just come out, and it makes things a lot easier.
We're talking about this size little book here. So it is, I'll show it to him.
It's like 3.5 by 5, maybe. Yeah, 3.5 by 5.
Yeah. So this is the size book that he enjoys working in, too. Because it's easy to... It's not so daunting, don't you think, because of the size?
Yeah, it's not very... there's not much surface area. You can put a whole lot, and if you like to draw small, like me, it's just... for some reason, it's like they go quick.
Yeah.
They're fun to do, and you don't have to make a huge commitment.
Yeah, one of the questions was, are you using watercolors? You do use some watercolor...
Occasionally, yeah.
It's for, like, accent things, right?
I like to... Because I've tried to color the whole piece before... And it just doesn't have the same feel because there's so much detail and so much of the detail gets lost.
Yeah.
And I feel like if you just splash some color, it's just, I don't know, I feel like it's way more expressive. So, I don't like to color the whole piece. I like to kind of let the black and white kind of tell the story.
And then your color is just like an accent type thing, right?
Yeah, and... maybe someone else knows. Right now, off the top of my head, I can't remember his name. The guy who illustrated Sin City, he would do mostly black and white, but say there'd be one character who was blue or red, or like, you know, the blood would be red, and there's something about the contrast that it's just absolutely captivating.
Yeah.
So that's kind of like the idea, and that I like to go with is just... you know, use color sparingly. You know, use it where it's needed, because one of my worst...
it's really effective.
Yeah, it's. But I mean, sometimes when there's too much color, it's kind of gaudy.
Yeah.
You know, and it depends on the piece. there will be times where, like, say I'll go into a place and there's a mural on the wall, and the mural is beautiful, but they're using orange and yellow and blue and tan and green mm-hmm. and red, and it's just like overload, mm-hmm. you know, sensory overload. I like to keep things a little subtle. Mm-hmm. Even with this mural that we're kind of working with, we're picking like maybe 3 or 4 colors and sticking, you know, black, white. The wall is like a brownish, kind of like the coffee sleeve. And we're going to use some like orange or red, mm-hmm. and we're going to let those all play together. Mm-hmm. It was inspired from a sign they had on the wall, and against the wall, it just looked absolutely like this is the color scheme that we want. Mm-hmm. And so I'm kind of like focusing too much on this grass here. I could probably move on. Got some of it down.
It's just fascinating to me to watch you use that pen. You're using such incredibly light touch with it. That's one of the things I love to watch artists do, because they can tell you something, but you have to really see them work with, you mm-hmm. know, how they hold the pen, how they hold the brush, you know,
right.
I can tell the pressure that you're using is so light, by much lighter than I expected.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really interesting to watch.
Yeah.
Frank Miller did Sin City.
Yeah, that's correct. I couldn't remember it for the
Thank
life
you,
of me
Ian there. Jackson. You saddest. You got. I'm telling you, I have the smartest audience in the world.
I'll
I'm
agree
not kidding.
With that.
They know. They can answer questions. They can find out answers. When I get stuck for something, somebody will fill in the blank. It's great.
Yeah, it's like I would have to look it up. I couldn't remember. But one of my favorite things to do on break when I'm at work is go into the graphic novel section and mm-hmm. just look at. I don't even read them because I don't have enough time to sit down mm-hmm. and read the whole thing. But I'll just look at the artwork and I'll take some pictures of some of the.
Look at the pictures, right?
Uh-huh, look at some yeah. of the panels and look at uh-huh. the covers. I love covers mm-hmm. of because sometimes the cover is completely different than the actual work, and it's mm-hmm. Especially the series Fables. A lot of those artists are just absolutely phenomenal. And that's some of my favorites, like James Jean used to do a lot of the art for them. But I suggest checking him out if you want some really, really great work to look at.
They're trying to tell me that they're not that smart.
I disagree.
They said,
I think they're pretty smart.
They said, more like we know how to use Google and Wikipedia.
Yeah.
I understand.
Yeah, I always like the challenge of trying to remember it, like going back yep. to the back when I didn't have a smartphone, mm-hmm. thinking like, oh, well, I don't know the answer
when
to this
remember
question.
Things.
I had to try to remember things or ask people. It's kind yeah. of fun for a little while. Mm-hmm. And then eventually you're like, oh, okay, I got to give in and use my phone.
Oh.
But, yeah, we're kind of in an impatient world nowadays. So we have so much knowledge yeah. at just our fingertips. Yeah. And it's great. But, I'm not very old. I was born in 91. But I can still, you know, remember having a phone with a cord and
yep.
mm-hmm. not having a smartphone.
Listen, when I was in school, we had to use encyclopedias to look up stuff. You know, and you talk about getting in trouble for plagiarism. If you sounded like you were copying out of the encyclopedia, they would nail you. Oh.
Oh, they would already know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
because of the style and, you know, so, yeah. And you had to use multiple sets of encyclopedias, so you had different authors' views of things and, yeah. Yeah, it's so much easier today.
Yeah, it's like I'll hear the stories of my parents talking mm-hmm. about what they had to go through, and mm-hmm. it's just like, man, I have it way easy.
Well, it's and you know, it's funny because when you grow, however you grow up, you know, whatever the things are that you did growing up that you worked with that were, you know, whatever it was, that was normal to you, and it seemed perfectly. It was just normal, mm-hmm. you know, it's what you did. And then things change and you see how it's different and easier in some circumstances for kids, your kids or grandkids, and you go, you know, I never thought I would say back in the day, but you know.
I mean, some people back in the day is like a year ago, 2 years ago, and it's like that's not quite back in the day.
Yeah.
But you know, it's I guess it's technically back in the day.
So Linda McAllister wants to know where you got your inspiration for this piece, like the birdhouses on sticks.
The original idea came from, you know, I have a lot of time, say, in the cafe to think, especially on, you know, dead days.
When it's not busy.
But I'm always constantly, when I'm driving around, looking at things and thinking about things, and say I see something on the side of the road, trying to be like, well, what would make this interesting? Like, mm-hmm. what if it was floating? What if there were planets around it? What if there was a giant robot inside of it? I don't know. So I'm constantly making up narratives in my own head, and then when I put them out into paper, sometimes it's just completely different. It goes a completely different route. This, the original piece that this one was based on that we showed before, came from a, there was like an old, it wasn't a train station, it was something around my hometown where trains would go and think people would load things up into these like cargo trains. And it was completely abandoned and falling apart. And there was a little tiny metal structure of, there was a catwalk that collapsed. And I thought it was just like one of the most interesting pieces of metal. And I took a photo of it. And in the piece, I started out with that and then just started incorporating other symbols that I was thinking about or seeing. And there was also... I have a friend who is, there's some family here in Colombia that lives out at the country club, and they have this massive old house, and they live, her and her husband live in the servants' quarters of this, like, mansion, and they pretty much do all the cooking and cleaning and all this for this family, and, you know, I had dinner with them one day, and I'd always go and have dinner, and I'd give them art lessons, and we'd talk about art and do little projects, and I'd never been during the day, and then one day during the day, I had never seen the yard, but there was a little statue of a wizard in their yard, and right next to a birdhouse, and it was like the most interesting little lawn ornaments ever, and it was, you know, it was in the winter still, so everything was dead, and you know, it just had this interesting feel to it, and I took a photo of it, and that's where a lot of the birdhouses came from and the wizard, and a lot of that being said, I guess I can say, like, with a lot of inspiration, a lot of people think that they have to, you know, go somewhere exotic, go somewhere that they've never been, but I mean, the world's pretty interesting where you're at.
Yeah.
You know, if you just open your eyes and look for it, you'll find some really interesting interesting things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the world is pretty surreal as it is without, you know,
without making it up.
Putting, you know, putting hats on octopuses and, you know, having floating characters. It's like, it's pretty, the world is pretty wild already.
Yeah.
So it's like, don't try too hard to be like interesting, like just kind of like, just look for it. So open your eyes and actually try to find it.
Turn that just a little bit so they can get a, for a second, so they can see the level of detail that you're getting in there.
So again, I just, with the grass, I just kind of tune out and just do it. And a lot of these plants, I just throw them in randomly as I go. It's just a lot of scribbling and just sort of fill in.
It's really, really fun to watch.
So line, like a lot of line with ink has a lot of movement, and movement
is... Sorry, you can put it however you
need. A lot of line has, it, like I said, has movement. One thing you want to think about is what direction lines are going. You want to think of the space and the composition, and triangles are very, very interesting composition. So a lot of my pieces are... a triangle, so you can kind of see each side of it. But it allows the viewer's eye to like flow and look all the way around the piece, and it's kind of a standalone. And a lot of my pieces do have like a lot of triangles, and I do that subconsciously, but I remember when I first started, I was trying really hard, like, how do I make this a very interesting, how do I make it interesting spatially?
Yeah.
But if you look at, if you're just putting random lines in, like a lot of this grass and stuff is just like, you can just see general lines moving around. So if, and again, like if you're going to go in with ink, if you're confident enough, you don't have to waste a whole lot of time drawing all the little tiny details of like every little leaf. You can do that all later. And again, that's like another exercise that when I stopped using pencil in my sketchbooks, it gives you a little bit more confidence.
Well, yeah, if you're just going straight in with ink.
Yeah, you're way more comfortable doing it later when you actually use pencil. When you have pencil, you're like, oh, this is easy. You know, it's just like, oh, okay, I don't have to, everything's already kind of, it's a roadmap for you already there, and you just go and flow. And again, like a lot of these things are things that I draw often. And I will have to get, like, a source image for something that I don't draw often. But, like, say for a lot of these plants, you'll find them in just about every single one of my drawings. And, again, another lesson that I was always taught in school by the artist I was talking about earlier who really, really inspired my own personal style was same as Lucas Dickerson. His work is absolutely incredible, but he told me, you know, he's like, stop trying to make things look exactly like you see it. And he's like, the goal is to make it look, you know, quote unquote, like-ish. Just make it look like it. And let your own, because it'll never look exactly like what you see unless you're really spending a lot of time on it. And
well, that hyper-realism is really that is some, here's my thought about hyper-realism. If you're gonna make it, if that's really what you want, why don't you take a picture of it?
Right. And my, I was trying to do realism for a while, and, you know, I have some stuff that is realistic, but it doesn't have, like, the same expressive punch as some of the other work. And it was always like, I would spend so much time grinding on it and making it, and then it would be there and be like, okay, it's cool and all. But, you know, eventually, you know, I was talking to my parents trying to figure out, you know, like, I don't know what I'm, what to do, what I'm doing. And my mom was just like, you know, realism's overrated. She's like, I have a camera, you know, I'm just like, okay,
I agree.
You know? And, I think the invention of the camera is kind of a beautiful thing, cause it did allow artists to get up, get out and express themselves differently. And expressionism was then, you know, created cause art originally was to document, you know, people, royalty, whoever. And then when there was, once there was a camera, like, oh, we don't need these guys.
Yeah.
So I think that is, that's kind of a big thing to think about is like, don't try to be realistically, you know,
let it's not it, just required.
Let it, yeah. It's, it's, let it flow a little bit.
So Ian Jackson wants to know if you like the art of Judge Dredd in the 2000 AD comics.
I've heard of Judge Dredd and people keep asking me about that. I still haven't checked it out though. So I'll definitely have to write that one down. But one of my favorite artists was especially for comics was Gabriel Ba and Fabio Moon. They're a couple of Brazilian artists who wrote Day Tripper. And I remember when I was in college, I used to read that all the time, and there's something about the characters that they draw that are just, they're not realistic, they're very expressive, and their lines are very just a wonderful line work, and it's, just have to check it out. But it's, the style is a lot different than mine, but sometimes you do have to, like, look at what other people are doing and get influence from, you know, draw inspiration from everyone. You know, don't trap yourself in a complete box.
Do you find that you try other people's styles just to see what it's like, or?
Well, I'll try a different material. Like, I'll use, say, a paintbrush or something, or I'll do, like, a dip pen or something just to see, like, you know, what's it going to look like. And you'll see that from one piece to another piece, what kind of materials you use will completely change the whole thing. Like, even moving from, say, a ballpoint pen to a Faber-Castell pen, you'll see a complete complete change where the Faber-Castell pen will look way more graphic, where the ballpoint pen will look a little more natural.
Yeah, you can't, I don't think you can get the shading with the Faber pens.
You can, it's a little bit, yeah, not in the same way, but it's a little bit different because the ballpoint, when it comes out, I don't want to say it's grittier, because not texturally grittier, but it looks like grittier.
Yeah. Rather it's, than the ink that flows out of the felt tip.
It's you can really use a ballpoint like a pencil. You just have to be a little more cautious. And for me, that helps out a lot, because whenever I use pencil, I'm all over the place. I'm going really fast. And then when I come back in with a pen, it's more, it's controlled. And I can tighten some of these loose pencil lines.
You're not doing anything on YouTube yet, right?
No, not I'm yet. I'm still kind of behind with the times with technology. I'm starting to get with it. I'm gonna try to get this website going first.
I'm gonna keep talking to him about YouTube and all this stuff. Yeah, I'm gonna keep talking to him.
Yeah, it's one of the things I realized when I got here is that I'm actually pretty hard to find on social media. I never realized it.
Well, I think, and everybody develops their preference with social media, you know, and so they tend to lock into one or two kinds of social media, and that's where they express themselves.
Yeah, you get stuck in a little social media box, I guess. But I actually, I didn't have Facebook throughout college. I had it at the end of high school, and then I really wanted to focus. I thought it was, you know, I'd be at home doing work and I'd find myself on Facebook. And I was like, oh, you know, distraction.
Right.
So I completely deleted it, and then I accidentally forgot the password, and I didn't have the email address anymore for it. So I had to make a brand new one. But it actually helped to completely get rid of it for a while.
Yeah.
While I was trying to develop myself as an artist. And, you know, it, I kind of miss a lot of those pictures that were on it, but, you know, hey, take some more. But, so with social media, I was kind of slow moving into it.
That's not a bad thing. That's not a bad thing.
Not at all.
No.
But, you know,
but what's amazing is how you can use it.
Right.
To get your art out there.
Right. You know?
Which is really, it's really great when you can do that.
Yeah.
Use it for what it's good for, you know?
Exactly. Kind of just like a side note here, like what I was saying about with ink being kind of unforgivable is that this little mushroom down here is a little darker and the lines are a little bit thicker than I really wanted them to be.
Yeah. Let's show them over here so they can see a little bit.
So it is just a little bit thicker than what I wanted it to be, and the lines are going a little bit everywhere. But the thing is, like, it's a very small little bit of the whole thing. So what we're going to do is just add something behind it to kind of mask it and add a shadow, and then...
And who knows?
And who knows, exactly. Maybe it'll go away. Yeah. Maybe it won't. I don't know. It's, again, it's a random...
I'm going to scoot you up just, just totally. A little bit.
Yeah, I keep forgetting that this whole thing isn't being filmed.
All right, can you work there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I don't know, we'll just add a stick behind it, see what happens with it.
See where it goes, right?
See what it's going to do. Maybe it'll work, maybe it won't, and if not, it's not a huge tragedy.
Well, and like you said, it's only one small part of the whole.
Yeah, it's no one's really going to actually see it unless I say, hey, check out this mistake I made.
Right.
But since we're, you know, for the sake of... You know, while we're working on this, you know, it's good to point out, like, where I'm going and why I'm doing.
Yeah, it's like, that wasn't what I had thought I was going to do, but look what happened.
Right, and it's like, add some shading, add a shadow back here, and, you know, it kind of, you can still see it, but it's still blended just a little bit. And also, it'll kind of maybe make this little tiny mushroom a little bit more defined. So again, like with some people where they're like, oh, I made a mistake, I got to start the whole thing over. It's like, wait a second, you know.
Yeah.
No. We can probably work around this.
So do you enjoy teaching people?
Yeah, I love giving lessons. I like I said, I have some friends that they'll make me dinner and we'll sit around and we'll draw and we'll just draw. Mm-hmm. We'll pick something out to draw, like, what are we going to draw today? And it's like, let's draw a treehouse. And, you know, we'll all draw our own treehouse and I'll kind of walk them through, like, what we're using, why we're using it, different lines. And while they're making it, I'll give them suggestions, like, say, hey, look at your line right here. This is really good. Why don't you bolden this or loosen it or erase part of it or whatever. And it's just kind of like learn as you go. And I get to do my work too.
So it's a true will work for food, huh?
Oh, yeah. You know, I've definitely been living the working for food and working for beer for a while. And, you know, it's there's nothing wrong with it. But it's, you know, right now it's not too bad. So.
Now, do you sell your work?
Occasionally, yeah. Mm-hmm. And it really depends on what piece it is. If it's going to be, like, say, in a showing that I want to do, I won't sell it just yet. But my plan is also to eventually go back to grad school when I'm, you know, comfortable enough. Mm-hmm. And be, you know, hopefully an art professor. Mm. And by the time
I'd be really good at that, Ian.
It's one thing that I would love to do. And I told my parents that's what I wanted to do, and they're completely supportive of all that. My whole family is like, all right, we're going to give them some time. Sure. Let him do his thing, and then we'll
Pressure him.
And then we'll pressure him. And it's I'm totally fine with what I'm doing right now, and I'm getting ready to apply, hopefully, in the next few months. So I don't know where I'm gonna go, but I'm kinda looking at different areas and looking at different programs. 'Cause I wanna learn under a professor that kind of will understand sort of, you know, where I'm coming from, where I'm going, my certain style. Because the last thing you want to do is, you know, be pen and ink surrealist artist and work under someone who does realism.
Yeah.
And it's like, I have no interest in doing realism, and I'd like to learn from someone as well.
Okay, so we had another question from Ian Jackson. He said he uses Winsor & Newton water-based color inks to add colors. And he wants to know what you use. So I think the answer was highlighters and watercolor.
Right? It depends on where I'm at with highlighters, but yeah, I'll use markers, I'll use watercolors, and I also like anything Faber-Castell is always my favorite, my go-to when it comes to art supplies, because I've just had really good luck with them.
Like the felt, like the colored pens.
Yeah,
and
I always have really good luck.
Pencils.
I'll use pencils as well. My colored pencil set is, and I don't use a whole lot of colored pencils anymore, but I like using Prismacolors. And, you know, they're not too expensive, and they have good tone. And another secret with the colored pencils is if you actually get mineral spirits, blending is a lot easier. So if you like to blend, and you can get rid of that gritty texture that
it's like magic. It just like melts.
It melts it. It blends it, and you can get great skin tones. You can get great anything.
Yeah.
Lines just smooth out.
Saves that waxy buildup from happening.
Yeah.
The same way.
Yeah, and it's like, I'm pretty detail oriented. I've never been.
I would not have guessed that.
I'm not much of a when it comes to general, like, painting was always kind of hard for me, because I had to put every little detail, every little pore, every little everything. And that's like one thing I'm kind of like, when I do have that, when I am using that media, like, I'll take that in consideration. Like, doesn't have to be every little, like what I'm doing now, like every little blade of grass.
Right.
But, you know, it's each material calls for something a little bit different.
Do you use watercolor pencils at all?
Yeah. Yeah. I have a set. I'll break them out every once in a while. Let me see. I think I have a color piece here that I can show. I thought I brought it. Maybe I didn't.
Ian says that Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencils are fabulous. I'm not familiar with that brand.
I'll have to check it out. Okay. I thought he was talking about the artist Albrecht Dürer. I'm like, I'm a huge fan. But which way am I turning it? This is one of the ones that I did on one of those art nights was a, we did all did a treehouse, and then we all broke out watercolors. And I guess it was a, you know, again, that's I let my personal life sometimes trickle in to my current, you know, whatever I'm doing at the time. So I was a little distressed at that time. So
so it just shows right up in your
heart.
Yeah,
it'll just show up.
Oh, that's great. That's fun.
I also love the idea of graffiti. One of my first, when I was in high school, there were a lot of abandoned bridges or, you know, out in the country, and we always used to go out and we would bring out spray paint, or we would fill up shoeshine bottles with paint, and we'd just go and we'd make drawings on these old bridges that are out in the country. You know, there's no one around for 10 miles.
Yeah.
And that's kind of where a lot of the graffiti stuff comes from, just that old nostalgic idea of, you know, us going and painting bridges.
Yeah.
So, we would always do, like, different characters.
Did you ever get in trouble?
No, we did ones that no one cared about.
Yeah.
So there were already 1,000 drawings on them. And that's kind of the beauty of some of those bridges that are out in the middle of, like, say, a cornfield, is that so many people have gone out, and it's just, it's just become part of the bridge. You're like, oh, it's so beautiful. All the colors, all the, the history. And, but if you think of, I really do love street art has always been, everyone loves street art. But if you think about with street art, it started out as, it's one of the most unchanged styles of art. You know, the materials have changed, but I mean, if you think about cave drawings were technically a version of street art.
They were just street art, weren't
yeah,
they
were just people going in and painting a horse up on a cave wall.
Here they were defacing the cave walls all those years
exactly.
ago.
It's like it was technically that was originally, you know, street
That's
art.
That's funny. I never thought about that.
So yeah, it's just like when it comes to actually creating, you know, yeah, you have, they were probably running from, you know, tigers and, you know, whatever.
Right.
But, you know, it's, game has changed, but the concept is kind of the same.
Yeah.
And it's the world around you. It's commentary on, say, something socially, politically. They were just trying to show the world, you know, what their world was like, you know, you know, tons of horses running or woolly mammoths, whatever. But yeah, it's fun to kind of connect those two and see, you know, where it's changed or where it's going.
Have you worked in other mediums like, clay and, jewelry and stuff like that?
I would like to. I'm kind of afraid of what I'd find out, you know, what I'm going to do, you know?
That you might fall in love with it?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
You know, I might end up, like, doing clay and, you know, eventually sticking with it. And it's like, you know, I think it'd be kind of fun. But eventually, it's one of the things.
Have you done any stuff with metal, like jewelry and silversmithing and that?
See, it's like in college, one of the classes that I always joined, but I never stuck with, because, you know, you have, like, 7 days to change to a different class. I would join a class while I was waiting for another class to open, and it was always like clay or ceramics or whatever. And I would sit there and I would make pinch pots or coil pots for like 2 or 3 days while I was waiting for another class to open up. And when that opening happened, I would just drop it and change to another class. So I've done a little bit of clay, but it was only for a few days. But I, you know, it's one of those things I'd love to check it out, and I'd love to maybe say take one of these drawings and do them in ceramic or see what it would look like 3D. It's that I have kind of thought about how things would look in 3D.
Yeah.
So eventually when I get to that point.
That would be fun.
Yeah, and eventually I hope that maybe I can get to a point where I have the materials on hand that I can make something or just see what happens. You know, it may be a complete and total, you know, meh. But you gotta try it out. You know, it could be a. It's like when you change your pen or you change your paint. It's like the new material can open up a whole new door.
Have you ever done any work with silver clay at all?
I have not.
Yeah,
no,
I haven't either. I think that is a fascinating medium. You know, because you're actually modeling with clay, but it's actually, I think it's like 99% silver. And then there's the binder with it.
Really?
And then you fire it, it burns away the binder, and it is this incredible silver.
Huh. Yeah, I'll have to, I need to check it out. I'm, like, pretty unfamiliar with it.
And they even have a bronze clay. I think they have gold clay too, but silver seems to be the one that I'm.
Silver always looks pretty.
I think started out, you know.
Yeah, I always wanted to do some type of like bronze sculpture. Mm-hmm. Like I was saying, like I'd love to see how this treehouse would look in bronze, and then paint over the bronze or something like that. But you know, again, like whenever that opportunity arises, I will definitely try it out. But until then, I don't really even know where to go about getting how to do bronze casting.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I don't even know. I don't know where to go.
Yeah.
Who to ask, or...
There was a guy that I went to college with, Larry is his first name. His last name has just flown out of my head. He's a very well-known sculptor here in town.
Okay.
Larry. Ugh. Maybe it'll float in a minute. Anyway, he has done a lot of the bronze pieces around Columbia here. And... I got to see, they've done some different documentary is probably not the right word, but they filmed some of his process that I've gotten to see. And yeah, with the lost wax casting and what he does is just pretty amazing. Why can't I think of his name? I'm going to have to look it up. I got to look it up because that's going to drive me crazy.
I know, I've met a few of the artists here in Columbia. I've gone to the First Fridays and gotten familiar with some of the local people. And there's a lot of really great talent in this area.
Which... Larry Young. Duh. Every once in a while you just go, oh, man.
You're like, right. I don't know.
Yeah, it's like, how did that one go away?
It's like Frank Miller.
Exactly. It's just like... goes, poof. Yeah. Well, I think we'll work probably about another 7 or 8 minutes.
For
so
sure.
So just do whatever you are comfortable with.
If there's anything anyone wants me to like move on to, I can try to do as much possible. Maybe if there's like...
We're not going to try and tell you what to do.
Yeah, I don't know. It's like it's all eventually going to be... It's all eventually going to be done.
That's right. We're not going to tell you what to do.
The thing is with these pens, like you don't get a lot of heavy blacks really quick.
So
sometimes you have to work on a line for a little while. So it's like you kind of chip away at the drawing. Mm-hmm. Say with a Micron pen or a Faber-Castell pen, you will get those blacks a little bit quicker and the drawing does go a lot quicker. You don't get that same... I debated using one today. But again, like I've been doing this whole series all with the ballpoint, and I didn't want to kind of stray away from that.
Sure.
And a lot of the drawings I'm showing are all ballpoints. I'm like, oh, look at all these ballpoint pens. I'm going to use a Micron pen now.
Yeah.
I didn't want to.
No, I think showing the ballpoint's perfect.
Yeah, but again, like just texture. Like you can make, like here, this is supposed to be, or it's going to be a metal, piece of metal, but just a little bit of cross hatching, you can get that kind of like metal grayness. Coat like go through like right here especially
and you can communicate that sense of roundness by the way your lines go
right and you know metal is usually pretty light. It depends on the metal of course, but a lot of like pipes are usually kind of like a mid gray, so you want to kind of go for that sort of mid gray like right here. And then one thing I like to do to make the lines kind of flow is kind of like pull the line down and kind of make like almost like a drip and it kind of makes everything flow. Like even down here, I was sort of doing it. It kind of adds the shadow and it gives it sort of more of like a grittier, darker.
It creates kind texture.
And it'll like a lot of my stuff is abandoned. It gives that abandoned feel like paint is being chipped or something's been leaking out of it or whatever.
Corrosion.
Right. And it's like, I just like the look of it. It kind of gives it more, there's a lot of feeling that comes out of that, and it tells you a little bit more about this piece, where if everything was like, you know, pristine and shiny and clean looking, that would give a whole another feel of like what this weird machine I'm drawing is. I know it's kind of hard to see it because it's been so far down. I'll show you guys the rest of it, because I know we've been kind of focusing on the grass, but the whole idea is, again, like, spring, April showers, life kind of trying to grow, but I like I said, like the stage props.
I love that.
And it's just a, there's going to be like a shower. It's a shower head behind the cloud. So that's my favorite part.
Let's turn it this way so they can see. So point out the shower head.
Yeah, my favorite part is just the shower head behind the flat, you know, hanging cloud. And so it's wrapping up around the stage prop. And that's eventually like there's water, you know, just cycling around. So it's like, you know, a water system that's just kind of draining and going back into the bathtub and coming back around. So water cycle, April showers, mm-hmm. you know, life trying to grow back out, birdhouses, etc.
The thing that I love about what you do is that, honestly, you have to smile at it, you know. A piece like this makes you smile.
It's fun, you know. It's got mm-hmm. that. It's got the.
I mean, not all of your pieces are smiley pieces.
But
there are smiley elements.
There's a professor that I was talking to here at Mizzou. I ran into. I would love to do printmaking because I love the idea mm-hmm. of creating multiples, and I work small, so creating a big series or multiples mm-hmm. is kind of key. But I met the printmaking professor one random night. I was out downtown somewhere, and he was talking about art with someone. I just asked him, like, oh, you know, I heard you're talking about art, and, you know, do you do art? And he's like, yeah, I'm a professor at Mizzou, and we just talked for the next couple hours. And one thing that we talked about was, you know, if your work is very dark, it's always good to put some type of humor into it to lighten it up, because it's all, like, gloom and doom.
Right.
It pushes people away, but you kind of want to have something fun about it that makes, because, you know, life isn't all happy and it's not all sad.
Right.
You know, you have like the ups and downs. So mm-hmm. a lot of the pieces, I feel like, kind of in, like, you know, capture like life as it is.
Yeah.
You know, especially a lot of like when you're driving alongside the road, you see an abandoned thing, mm-hmm. you know, it's you know, not happy, but it's not also totally sad.
But there's also usually some beautiful flower mm-hmm. crawling up, you know.
Right. There's like, and when you go inside of it, there's one time when I was outside of one of the small towns around here, there was like an old barn that I found on the side of the road, and I had to circle back around, and it wasn't really a barn. It was an old garage, and that had just fallen to pieces, but there was this old, beautiful car just parked in it, and there were just flowers growing all around it, and it was definitely last summer, but mm-hmm. it's definitely, like, one of those things where it's like, oh, this is abandoned, but there's this old, crazy car from, like, the 60s in here that's just been lost, but the car, mm-hmm. like, it obviously been weathered a little bit, but it mm-hmm. still looked great, like, you could have mm-hmm. restored it, again, there's a little mix of all the feelings there everywhere mm-hmm. you go.
Yeah, yeah, really. Ian said here, Ian Jackson said that he loves a ballpoint pen that doesn't work very well because he gets great textures with a pen that's kind of running out of ink.
Yeah, yeah.
Interesting.
Kind of like when the ink is a little spotty.
Yeah.
Again, I used to do that, especially with like Micron pens. Like when Micron pens are starting to go out, you get that kind of like, it's almost gritty.
Yeah.
And you can shade a lot easier with it.
I should keep those pens.
Yeah.
I find myself throwing those away.
So I had a...
it's a good idea.
I have like a whole box of like new Microns and then I have shaders.
That's a good
idea.
So
I have a whole nother box
of
ones
that are
just for shading.
That's a really good idea. I gotta remember that one.
So, yeah, you got to keep shaders around.
Yeah.
And, you know, it depends on your style. Like, a lot of people go, like, heavy cross-hatching.
Yeah.
And cross-hatching works for them. And, like, there's an artist named Aaron Horky who, his stuff is absolutely, like, on the level of, like, Escher. Mm-hmm. And some of his, he does a lot of birds and he does all kinds of things. And everything is very much a pattern with texture mm-hmm. and cross-hatching.
Mm-hmm.
And, so with some people it works, but then like a lot of the artists that I like, they do a lot of the blending and a mm-hmm. lot of like, you know, using shading pens where you get that grittiness. And mm-hmm. I like the patterns, but mm-hmm. I also like to just kind of grind.
I just think it's cool that you get all of that with one pen.
Yeah, and this one's not totally, I don't think it's totally out of ink just yet. A lot of these, I'll like start using them and then they'll start mm-hmm. to kind of fade out.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, this one's getting close.
Yeah, it's almost gone.
So it's almost there, but eventually, like, I'll be doing lines like, why isn't the ink coming out like it should? And then, yeah, you realize, like, oh, this one's almost burned out.
Well, let's see. If anybody else have any last questions they want to pop in the chat, go ahead and stick them in. We have a couple people that just showed up and are sad that they missed the rest of it, but it will be up on a recording. You can see it sometime over the weekend. You'll be able to see the rest of the whole kit and caboodle. So if you have any other questions, any last burning things that you want to know from Ian Cody, please put them in the chat. Otherwise, we're going to wrap it up here in a little bit. And of course, the sponsors have to make an appearance because, well, let's be honest, Ian's never met the sponsors. And
I have not yet. I haven't really interested.
I told him there were two big fat Siamese, and that's true. You guys can attest to the fact that it's true.
So, again, if you have any questions or want to reach out.
Linda McAllister says, okay, you know, you can like the video. You can thumbs up the video. She says, this week her like is for Ian. Sorry, Barb.
Well, thank you.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, feel free to reach out to me on Facebook or Instagram. And I'm currently working on a website, so, okay.
Facebook, stay tuned. Facebook or Instagram, they can stay and get in touch with you there.
Mm-hmm. Or you can email me, whatever works. And it's hard. Emails, I'm not really, it takes me a couple days to get back, but, yeah.
So on email, I will have all of his social media links and all of that. I'll have all of that stuff in the description box when we do the recording and so forth. So, okay, let me get the sponsors. I'm going to switch places with you because the big fat cats will take up space. They have to get on the table. Are you coming? Yeah, see, they know. They know it's their turn. Ooh, a stranger in the midst. Yes, a stranger is in the house. I know. This is Chance.
What's going on, Chance? Oh, and there's the other one.
And that's Charlie. All right, so, oh, don't forget your coffee sleeve here.
Ow.
All right, I got to get the kitty cam ready to go here. Yeah, we got to get, whoops, kitty cam. Ready to go here. Lie down. Yep, here's Mr. Chance. Come here, Charlie. Come here, Fetzo. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, get up here and get your 5 minutes of fame. Lie down. Okay, here we go. See? Sponsor time. Yes.
They love the attention.
Oh, they do. They totally enjoy being in front of the camera. I don't know why. And usually somebody has cruddy eyes, and this one often starts coughing, so he gets banned from the table real quick.
Oh, poor guy.
I know. Okay, so, yeah. That's it, you guys. Thank you so much for joining us today. This is Ian back here behind the cat ear. You get to see him in person. Thanks for joining us. We've had, I don't want to keep your sketchbook. That would be bad news. That's right. That would be bad.
See you, Barnes.
I'd have to return it. Yeah, so it's been fun to see you guys. Thanks so much for joining us for another Drama Free Friday. Thanks for keeping it drama free and keeping it real. And, yeah, I will see you guys next Friday at 2 p.m. Eastern time. And, you know what we say around here, remember to get creative today because, you know, it's easy. And we'll see you next time. Bye, everybody.